welcome to Time and Again. Cross a puppet with a marionette, and what do you get? Well, maybe not much of anything unless you also add a little magic. That's what a puppeteer named Jim Henson did when he was still a teenager back in the 50s. What he conjured up has been entertaining children of all ages ever since, the Muppets. Henson's menagerie includes some of the biggest names in show business. Kermit the Frog, Miss Piggy, Big Bird, Oscar the Grouch, Fozzie Bear, Elmo, the Cookie Monster, Bert and Ernie, and even a Jedi Master named Yoda.
War's not make one great, Tim.
But the Muppet story has humble beginnings, including a local TV show back in the 50s called Sam and Friends on NBC station WRC in Washington.
Man, you're just a beginner. I'm an old hand at this stuff. Watch. Hey, a real watch.
People took notice. National TV appearances followed. Commercials, too. The breakthrough came in 1969, Sesame Street. Before long, a show of their own, and there were Muppet movies.
Wow.
And movies with fantastic characters that were anything but cute.
The story runs deeper than you know.
Through it all, the man behind the Muppets never lost his gentle humor, his creative vision.
I certainly am doing what I love to do, and I can't think of anything else that I'd rather do besides what I'm doing. And I don't, you know, I think anybody that's, you know, it's fortunate to be that way. I think a lot of people maybe don't do what they love doing most.
Jim Henson loved what he was doing until the day he died, quite suddenly, of pneumonia, on May 16, 1990. But his spirit certainly lives on. On this episode of Time and Again, the world of Jim Henson and the Muppets. They had a special relationship with the Today Show over the years. So let's begin there. Here are just a few of the highlights.
Hey, listen.
Good morning.
You know the green room? You know you said you had a green room? You went back to the green room?
Yes.
It's brown.
I know.
Seriously. Seriously.
Well, where do you see
you call that a green room? That's not a green room. I thought it was a green room for frogs, you know, stuff like that.
On the television.
Listen, folks, it's not a green room. What they promise here, they don't always speak the truth on this show.
Do you feel blue about having an unrequited love affair with a frog?
It's not unrequited.
It's not?
It is so.
Did you ever hit anybody?
Well, I wouldn't hit you. I'd just give you a little poke.
A poke chop?
Oh, I see it coming, folks.
I think it's time to talk, and I think it's time to talk about us.
It's not time to talk about us, Piggy. We're
here
talking to Deborah about the talking.
Shut out!
Piggy.
I am trying to talk to my frog about something that I've been trying to talk to for a long time, which is, I think it's not
Piggy.
Working between the two
Piggy,
of us.
Don't
oh,
talk.
No.
Piggy,
oh,
please try not to get into this stuff right now.
Don't touch me!
My gosh! What is this, a platonic relationship now? What's the deal?
I'm going to get my shot. Well, you see, they were a single of Kermit, you see? Now
oh,
I can't see me.
Yeah. Let the frog talk about this.
3 hours of makeup and I get zilch.
You know what?
What, dear?
I think we have to wrap things
of
up.
Of course, a single. One question, I'm gone.
Oh, she's so demanding, isn't she, Kermit?
You know, well, listen, yeah, she can be.
I hope you don't get too upset about this, but since Kermit's an experienced broadcaster, mm-hmm. we're going to have him do this.
I'm very proud of Kermit.
Oh, okay. We'll be right back. This is Today on NBC.
That's wonderful.
Very good.
Thank you.
Isn't that wonderful?
Thank
wow.
you. That
I
was
excellent. Let's see if we have the sitting arrangement right. Do I have a wide shot, please? I just want to see where we are here. Okay, let's see. It's boy, Matt. Boy, and what's your name? Okay, we're all set.
If I were to ask you out one night, would you consider going with me? Quickly, we're out of time.
What are you doing with that pencil? I don't know, Matthew. I mean, I think we have forgiven each other. I think so.
I just realized.
Yes?
We have two of the biggest noses in television.
By the way, how's Antoinette?
Annette.
Fine, whatever.
Guys, can we go to Willard?
Yeah. Don't worry about it, guys.
We are under control. Hey, you want to save me some cheese?
Yeah, do you want cheddar or do you want this your limburger? All right, stand by Washington.
Yeah, fine. Does anybody know what this button does
over
here?
Hey, Bucky, you want the Gorgonzola?
Oh, Washington is standing by.
Cut to Washington.
Yeah, how do I get to Washington?
I don't know. You press a button or something. I don't know.
Ah!
I'd like to apologize this morning that we've given most of our regular technical crew the day off to celebrate New Year's.
And I think the substitutes are still celebrating New Year's Eve, apparently.
Hey, I'm trying my best over here. I only got two stubby little hands.
Talking about a rat pack, huh?
Yeah.
Are you the replacement that were sent over for the day?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, sir.
Do you have any experience at this sort of thing?
None whatsoever. But I'm a very good anchor, if you would like to go home now.
How much longer are you going to be here, dear? I got a tour group waiting to come in.
Well, listen, my little MBC page breath. Yes, we're doing a show here, dear.
Oh, good. I thought you might be doing something important. Come on in, folks.
Come in. Oh, look how swanky. Yes. This is so lovely.
Now, this is Studio 1A. It's all of the Today Show.
Would you just give me one little kiss?
My pleasure. One kiss. Let's make it two. No, three. Four kisses. Five, six, seven, eight.
Okay!
Being that I am a grouch, I would never come to a nice, friendly show like this.
Sorry, I'm sorry. You go.
No, go.
No, you go.
No, you
go.
Your show.
No, you go.
You go. You go.
I'm making you an official bird gateer.
Oh, boy. You mean I'm really part of the group now?
Yes. Well, you have to do the ceremony.
The Muppets, their 45th anniversary on the Today program, and as far as I'm concerned, the best one ever. Thank you very much for being with us, Grover.
Where's Kermit? Where's Hugh Downs?
What? Where's Hugh Downs?
Jim Henson, Frank Oz.
Where's Dave Garraway?
And
Dave Garraway?
We told you the Muppets go back a ways on Today. Dave Garraway was the show's original host, and he, too, was no stranger to the Henson magic. Here he is in a rare and long unseen segment from 1961.
Going now to two of the best people in the world, I think. They're Jim and Jane Henson, and they have two friends, or several, called marionettes, whom they bring to life. They're called Muppets because they're neither puppets nor marionettes, but kind of a combination. They invented them a while ago, and we're about to join them this morning, and I hope many more mornings, too. Once you see a treatment of, say, an old song like, Yes, We Have No Bananas, you'll be a Muppet fan, too, I bet you. Here we go to Washington and Jim and Jane Henson.
Yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today.
Green peas and onions, cabbages and scallions,
and all kinds of fruit and things. We have an old tomato.
And look at that Long Island potato.
About yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today. We have no bananas today. We have no bananas today.
You know, Al, we're all out of bananas.
Yes, Phil, it's a good thing.
We have
Gee, that's great, fellas. Sure is nice to hear sensible, solid, sensible lyrics like that instead of all that rock and roll talk we hear today.
NBC's Dave Garraway playing host to the Muppets on Today in 1961. Behind the scenes, a 25-year-old Jim Henson with his wife, Jane. A little later, we'll hear from Jane Henson remembering her late husband. But when we come back, the men behind Kermit and Miss Piggy, Jim Henson and longtime collaborator Frank Oz.
In truth, you never know why something really works. You just have fun with it. Like Jim and I have fun with Kermit and Piggy because the relationship works. But really, who knows?
Good morning, Kermit.
Good morning, Gene.
I'm really glad to see you here. You know, Jim Henson was here yesterday. You know Jim?
Well, you know, he's a guy that I hear a lot about. You know, and I keep hearing that he's around and he seems to have his hand in about everything, but I don't particularly know much about him.
Kermit, the world's most famous frog and one of Jim Henson's earliest Muppet creations dating back to the mid-50s. In 1977, they were both Gene Shalit's guests on Today, along with Henson's longtime collaborator, Frank Oz. The occasion, the 45th appearance of the Muppets on Today.
Did you invent the Muppets?
I guess so, Rock, yeah.
About when was that?
It was about 22 years ago.
22 years ago.
Yeah.
You've been on the Today Show. This is today, their 45th anniversary.
That's amazing.
In our 25th anniversary.
I was so surprised, yeah. We did the show a lot about 13, 14 years ago.
That was coming out of Washington.
When we were first, yeah, we used to do cut-ins when Garraway was doing it. And and then we came up here. When I first moved to New York, this show was one of the reasons of coming up.
Kermit, how long have you been with Jim Henson? How did you meet Jim?
I'm one of the oldest around.
Are
actually.
You?
Yeah, yeah. I've been. What are you doing, Grover?
It's just a nice fabric.
You're upstaging.
Of course I am.
Know that.
Yes.
He's a great upstager.
No, I will not upstage, okay?
Kermit, what kind of a... I know you're a frog. And
no, I didn't answer your last question, though.
I don't even remember it.
Oh, you asked how long I've been around. I wanted to
how
answer that.
How long have you been around, Kermit?
Listen, about, 20 years, actually.
Really?
I'm one of the old guys.
A 20-year-old frog?
Yep.
And where's your pad?
My what?
Your pad.
I have a penthouse.
A penthouse? I thought all frogs lived on pads.
Oh, no, listen,
penthouse.
Not when you're a big star.
Do you consider yourself a big star? When you get up in the morning, do you say?
Sure.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Do you think Grover's a big star?
No.
How long did it take you to come up with Grover?
Grover was a very long-term thing. It took about a year before I was satisfied. It just happened with Grover. Grover's...
Speak to me, Groverly.
I'm sorry, I cannot do that.
Grover's character, because I do Cookie Monster, too.
How's Cookie Monster talk?
I mean, no.
And he... They both have a language that's fun to play with, and Cookie Monster uses a lot of me's instead of I's.
But suppose Grover were talking to Cookie Monster. Could you do 20 seconds now of them exchanging greetings if they met, or how are you, or how do you feel today? Just to see you switch from one voice to another instantaneously?
But this I could do. How about you, Cookie? Oh, me no, me can do that.
Well, I do not. Who is this fellow?
Gene Shalit?
You had to be at the Academy Awards because Miss Piggy was at the Academy Awards. And I understand they rarely let her travel alone. They like a chaperone. She's a wicked woman, after all. A woman of the world with her feminine wiles.
She's a lady.
Yeah, she's a lady. Pork chop is what she is.
She's a lady, and if you don't think she's a lady, she'll cut you in half. That's all there is to it.
Now, you created that character.
Yeah.
Is there an amalgam of real people in her, or is she absolutely fantasy? Is there any Mae West, for instance, in Miss Piggy?
No, I didn't pattern her after anyone. It just came from my warped view of women. it just kind of happened.
Well, suppose I came up to Miss Piggy at a party and I said, how do you do, Miss? Are you here with anyone? What would she say?
It depends. I'm with Kermit.
You're with Kermit?
She's really a one-frog pig.
Just between us, what do you think of Kermit?
I want him desperately.
Do you really?
Come on now.
What do you think of Miss Pig?
Well, there is no truth to the rumors about us.
Have you been a little bit astounded by the popularity of the Muppets, particularly Kermit and Miss Piggy, who have become household names around the world?
Well, Piggy in particular just took off in the last year or so, and I have no idea why. Maybe Frank knows.
Hey, I don't know a thing about how Miss Piggy is that popular. I mean, Piggy's just come around the past 4 or 5 years with the Muppet Show. And she just came out, I think, through my sick views of women in the world and things, I don't know. But in truth, you never know why something really works. You just have fun with it. Like Jim and I have fun with Kermit and Piggy because the relationship works. But really, who knows?
The Muppets are now among the best-known entertainers in the world, it's fair to say. And Henson and Oz are known as names, but not necessarily as personalities. Do you sometimes miss the fact that you can't be identified more clearly in a personal way with their success?
We have the opportunity, like now.
Right.
And then when people don't know us, it's kind of nice to be able to go into the supermarket and get a can of beans and not be bothered. But when we go to the Academy Awards or Emmys or something, and then we're known, I get my ego massage then. So I think we get the best of both worlds. It's fun that way.
But I don't miss being a celebrity. You know, just having the guests that we did with the Muppet Show, so we spent a lot of time with all of those different people and going to dinner and so on. And that whole, you know, thing that's around, as you must know, you know, you're recognized everywhere you go and that sort of thing. And we're not, and that's, I don't miss that. That's nice.
Jim Henson with Frank Oz on Today with Tom Brokaw in 1981. As you've seen, Henson was a frequent visitor to NBC over the years, but it turns out he did more than just appear on television while he was here. He also did a little redecorating. We'll show you what we mean when Time and Again continues.
We tried to find a pith helmet. That's a pith helmet for Gene Shalit, but we couldn't find one to fit his head, so we've just sent him off on a voyage of discovery this morning, hatless. Gene Shalit now, out in a hallway here, somewhere in the depths of the RCA building. Gene, what have you found?
NBC is chopping this place apart. There's always some construction going on here.
And the other day, some workmen with sledgehammers were knocking down a wall, and they found some pipes. And they said, you sure you want us to take these pipes out of here? Because these were very special pipes. Now, will you look at this? And the man standing next to the pipes is Jim Henson. Hi, Jim. What is this?
Good morning.
What is this cave we're in here? This is, as you can see, folks, there's a lot of building going on here.
It's very strange because this was our dressing room when we were here doing the Jack Parr show. And that was about, 17, 18 years ago. And this was a closet that was here in the dressing room. And we just opened the door one morning and we saw the pipes, which we thought were very funny. So we started to paint them.
You always carry paints with you, Jim, whenever you go out?
Well, let's see. You know, it was one of those, it's a variety show, and in between the dress rehearsal and air, you usually have a couple hours to kill. So we went back across town and got some old fur fabric and paints and stuff like that.
And look at this, folks. Here we have a pipe. This is I have a flashlight here because I want to show you some of the stuff in here. You can see this dark closet. Here's a handle on this pipe, which becomes the nose, right, of this guy.
Right.
Where'd you get the hair?
Well, it's I think it's fur fabric. There's one piece down here. See this one right here?
See right here, folks?
That fur fabric right there. That's a piece of the original Grover.
Really?
Yeah, it's a Grover.
Grover?
That's Grover in memoriam. Right there, yes.
And here you have sort of hieroglyphics.
Yes.
Can you see all that right on there?
I don't know what that means.
And here we have some people. And down here, very much on the bottom. Can the camera see down there where my flashlight is? Read what that says.
That's what
with the love from the Muppets.
Right.
If you had dated it, our archaeological expedition could have been really right on the money. We would have known exactly when you did it,
That's true.
They didn't date the pyramids either, though. There's no dates in there.
There's a carbon dating system they might be able to use here.
We also almost...
It's so strange. When we did it, we thought... they told us. We were just going to do it and sneak out and not tell anybody. And then they found it immediately, and they said, well, it's very cute, but we'll paint it out tomorrow. And so at all times they've been saying they're going to paint it out and get rid of it.
They will never paint it out. I would like it to know that NBC is making this into a museum. This is going to be here, Jim, in your honor forevermore. The Jim Henson Memorial Pipes. Even in the fuse box up there, there's a sun. The whole back wall is drawn. This is really, really remarkable. We're going to keep it. I want you to know we're never going to turn off these faucets.
That was 1980. We're happy to tell you after all these years, Jim Henson's pipes are still here. This was part of a dressing room for the Jack Parr show back in the early 60s when Henson left his mark. These days, the space is occupied by Late Night with Conan O'Brien. Still a remarkable sight after all these years. When we come back, some very different kinds of characters in the movies.
Ah, now that's more like it.
And Jim Henson is remembered by those who knew him best. One time and again, continues.
Well, I think he found life very, very rich. And every time, if something got him down, he'd turn a corner and something was wonderful.
Welcome back to Time and Again as we spend some time with Jim Henson and the Muppets. From the beginning, the Muppets were made for television. Local TV in the mid-50s, the Today Show in the early 60s, Sesame Street beginning in 1969, the original Saturday Night Live in the mid-70s, and a show of their own, The Muppet Show, starting in 1976. But there have also been movies, including The Muppet Movie, The Great Muppet Caper, and The Muppets Take Manhattan.
What's going on?
You're going on. It's Broadway. You made it.
Yeah, right.
Jim Henson liked to entertain kids with his characters, but his creative vision did not end there. In 1982, with the release of an elaborate fantasy called The Dark Crystal, NBC's Jim Brown had a look at the Muppet phenomenon.
First, there were puppets. Then, there were Muppets. Then came a philosopher called Yoda.
Great warrior.
And last summer, an extraterrestrial named E.T. Now, there's a movie that combines all the advances made in creature technology called The Dark Crystal, in which manipulated characters completely take the place of human actors.
Master, what's wrong?
You are in danger, Gilfling.
The Dark Crystal is a fantasy about good and evil, trials and tribulations, curses and witches, complete with a bright-voiced hero and a long-haired heroine. The Dark Crystal belongs to Muppet creator Jim Henson and his co-director Frank Oz.
What is exciting about this whole process is that I think we've come to the point where you can do almost anything in a film that you dream up, no matter what kind of imagery. And I think that's borne out in the other films recently, in the last couple of years. And I think that's very exciting. And I think films now, it's expensive, because this was an expensive film. But basically, I think we've reached the point where you can do almost anything that you can conceive of.
Henson says what separates The Dark Crystal from what has come before is the level of realism.
The Muppets are basically what I think of as puppetry, where it's half a caricature, it's almost a cartoon, it's a stylized form of life. And with this film, what we tried to create were characters that actually lived and breathed. So we're trying to really create something that people will believe is alive.
The Skeksis killed my mother and father.
The story runs deeper. Then
this is a mystic, and we had about three or four major types of characters, and there are nine of these mystics in the film. And basically, he's operated, when he's moving, he's operated by a single person inside, and it's a very difficult position to, because when you actually walk down on your haunches. And we had a team of performers that worked about, 6 or 8 months before we started shooting, working out every day, deciding how each of these guys moves and that sort of thing. But basically, you're operating with the weight of the hand on your right hand. The left hand is in here. And then there are cable controls that do things like eye movement. This guy here is Jen, and he's sort of a major character that goes through the film, and I was operating him. And so most of the time with him, one is operating up through the center of the body, more like a regular puppet in terms of manipulation. But we'd have a team of people doing the eyes, which were on radio control. The complicated thing about performing these guys, as opposed to performing things like the Muppets, these things look very alive, and that was our whole intent, was to make them look like a living thing. And so the subtlety of the performance is what was complicated.
Kira, you don't have to go.
I know.
We were trying to solve the problem of how to manipulate a particular kind of thing that our Gelflings had to get on and ride very fast. And one day, one of our performers, who was a clown, came in with his 10-foot stilts. And he was walking around the rehearsal room, and all of a sudden it dawned on us that this could be a basis of a creature. These are our pod people, sort of podlings. They're the peasants that sort of live out in the forest, and they're very simple people. This is the closest thing to sort of normal puppetry in the whole film, because most of these are operated just about like regular hand puppets. The whole set was done operating up through the floor. To me, this film was a marvelous challenge, and so we went into it not really knowing if we could pull it off, but it's kind of the most exciting challenge that we've tackled so far.
Jim Henson in 1982. 4 years later, building on what he'd learned making The Dark Crystal, Henson and his creative team came up with Labyrinth, with Star Wars creator George Lucas as executive producer. The creatures in Labyrinth were a far cry from your everyday Muppets.
Now, would you go left or right?
Hi there, and welcome to one of the sets of our new movie, Labyrinth. Like everything else around here, things are not always what they seem.
See? There's nothing to be afraid of.
Well, to me, the film is really about growing up. It's really about the maturing process. When we were casting it, I didn't realize that we had a lot of scenes that were going to be, they're potentially difficult or uncomfortable or look dangerous. I don't think any of them were dangerous, but we had areas where, and the Shaft of Hands was one, where Jenny was way up at the top of the studio. She's sort of suspended in the air with nothing beneath her, and she's, 40 feet in the air. This is a scary situation to a lot of people.
And 3, 2, 1, drop.
21, 20, 19, 18, 17, 16.
And cut. That's a good one.
Labyrinth showcased the work of Jim Henson's Creature Shop, which evolved into a business in its own right, providing creative and technical expertise to other filmmakers. It produced characters for Babe and Dr. Doolittle, even prosthetics for the film The English Patient. When we come back, the Muppets return to television on the Jim Henson Hour, including a guest appearance by yours truly in a moment.
Good morning, America.
Watch your language, Fozzie. The Muppet Show ran on television from 1976 to 1981. In 1989, the Muppets were back on TV in the Jim Henson Hour. Henson talked to me about the new show that April in one of his last television interviews. This can't be just a children's show.
No, it's really, it's a family show. I think of most of the stuff that we've ever done is really for families. But the show has, there are parts of it that are a little more adult than we've done in the
past. What exactly are you doing? I mean, if I were to describe it, I would probably use the word anthology, and I'm told that we're not supposed to use that word.
That's right. We don't call it that, but it's sort of a mixed bag of things.
Kermit the Frog has joined us.
Hi, Jane.
You know, Kermit, I was going to introduce you as Kermit the Star, but, you know, I couldn't help but notice that Jim's going to name this show after himself, the Jim Henson Hour.
Yes.
Is there any trouble amongst the Muppets that he has stolen the thunder, shall we say?
Well, we talked about doing the Kermit the Frog show, you see. And I actually thought that was a better title for the show. But they're doing some stuff that's not Muppets, so they decided not to do that.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
Jim is playing himself. How would you, Kermit, critique Jim's performance on camera as himself?
Well, I think he's sort of stiff and not terribly entertaining. I mean, you know, some of us Muppets are funny and witty. But, you know, the guy is kind of a stiff.
Kermit,
you know?
When he's sitting on camera mouthing the words, are you really the voice?
Am I the voice for
Jim?
The man.
Uh-huh.
Now you're getting very surrealistic. I don't understand this.
Well, this
How could that be?
Yeah,
oh, yeah.
Television.
Wow. I don't know. Yeah. Perhaps.
Well, you two get together and...
I've never understood the concept
it.
Of alter ego in the first place.
I understand. Kermit, it's always a pleasure to see you, and I look forward to seeing you in primetime on
nice
NBC.
Hey, you know what?
What?
I don't know if the audience knows this, but Jane is actually going to be on this show. How about that? You came and you did a brief appearance.
It was so
Lillard
much fun.
And Scott is going to be on the show, too?
Yeah, as ourselves.
Yes, yes.
More or less.
Terrific.
In all
and, you,
of our
and you were great.
Minor glory. Great?
Ooh, yes, wonderful.
Yeah. You going to use that in a blurb? Jane Pauley.
Yes, exactly.
Jane Pauley
is great.
Great.
She should have a career on television.
Kermit may or may not be an astute judge of talent. You can judge for yourself. Here's that clip from the Jim Henson Hour with cameos by me and Willard. Welcome back to Today. It's time for the weather with Fozzie Bear.
Help! 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 Willard, is that camera on?
It certainly is.
Ah! Good morning, America.
Watch your language, Fozzie. Now, what were you saying?
Oh, nothing. Nothing except, I am your new weather bear. See, I got my pointy stick and everything.
Well, that's very professional, but isn't that Willard's job?
No. Funny you should ask. Willard could not make it. He told me to take over.
Wait a minute. Where's Willard?
Ha-ha! I'm your new weather bear. Ha-ha-ha. And, holy cow. Well, I guess, as you can plainly see, there's all this white stuff over here. Oh, a cute little pennants up here. There's a giant owl over here by Nebraska. Now, all you people in Nebraska, you stay in your homes until we can find a way to get the owl out of there. Yeah, well, now, over here, we have a man with a fruitcake.
Oh, Fozzie. Fozzie, I'm afraid you're just not cut out to be a weather bear.
I know.
But now, hold it. Listen, I found some great stuff in my closet that I think you are going to love.
What?
Take a look at this. A big nose with glasses? Huh? Is that your
art? Yes.
And a slightly used whoopee cushion.
Oh, my old friend.
But wait a minute. I saved the best for last, baby. This is it. A hilarious banana peel.
Now, that's funny.
Whoop. Waka waka.
Waka waka.
Waka waka.
Waka waka. Waka waka.
in a spin. Love is a spin I'm in. Under the old black magic called love. Under the old black magic called love.
Oh, that was about 17 when I first started building puppets and working on television. And for a long time, it was just something to do to go through college and paying my way through school. And then very slowly, I realized that this could be an occupation, that this is something that one could, that a grown man could do for a living.
Jim and Jane, thank you, and we'll be seeing you very soon, too.
Thank you, Doug.
You're wonderful. Bye. Every time we see you. The Muppets from Washington. Boy, they're great.
Jim Henson with wife Jane on Today in 1961. He was great, all right, and when he died suddenly of pneumonia on May 16, 1990, fans around the world mourned his passing. He was just 53. 3 years later, Jane Henson, son Brian, and longtime partner Frank Oz remembered Jim Henson.
Well, when I first met Jim, he was just coming out of high school, and by that time he was very interested in puppets. He had already started on television in Washington.
What was it, do you think, he found so appealing, Jane, about this
about
whole
puppets?
Art form? Yeah.
He enjoyed all theater. Mostly he was doing sets and things like that in high school and a little bit of puppets, but mostly he was intrigued with television. And Bert Hillstrom had Kukla, Fran, and Ollie on at that time, and Bill Baird had puppets on, and he was intrigued by their puppets on television, but mostly he was intrigued with television. And he had an opportunity to try some puppets on television.
Brian, what was it like for you growing up in this household? Was it crazy?
No, it wasn't a crazy house. I think my father worked very hard, and he spent a lot of time at the studios and the workshops and stuff like that. So the Muppets didn't really come home. We went to the studios a lot. The family spent a lot of time in the workshops and in the studios, but we didn't have Muppets running around the house, but it was a very creative household. We went a bit nuts painting walls and boxes and things all over the house, and bathrooms.
Kermit's one of the most beloved characters and someone who was very special to Jim Henson. How did the Kermit character come about in the first place? Do you know? I mean, what is it about frogs?
He made Kermit as soon as he was on television because he realized that a flexible head like the flexible head would be very powerful. Full screen, just as powerful as a human head.
What do you think Jim would want his legacy to be?
Probably to use your imagination and your humor and all the gifts of being able to enjoy what's beautiful and funny and foolish and all of that, to use it to make your life better and to make life better for everybody else and to enjoy each
other. I think it's to keep going. I think that's very true.
Life very, very rich. And every time, if something got him down, he'd turn a corner and something was wonderful.
Well, I know that he brightens my life every day and the lives of so many other people.
I think he did affect a lot of people, and with very simple puppets, so, you know, quite a strong statement.
I always knew Jim was a unique person. I just didn't know how important his uniqueness was to the world until after his death. But also, when you talk about Jim, it's not puppeteer. You're talking about the guy who performed, he directed. He also worked with the writers. He produced. He would be constantly editing, performing, flying. And throughout that strength, he also had the strength of will.
You called him a unique individual. What were his characteristics or the attributes that seemed to set him apart from others?
His sense of decency and fairness in a business which is extremely competitive, is one thing. He would be extraordinarily patient. Extraordinary. I've seen him on sets where people do things wrong and some other director would say, get him out of here. He would say, no, just give him a chance. He'll be okay.
Did he sort of ignore his fame?
He was aware of it. He was pleased with it because I think more than anything else, he was pleased because the fame could allow him to do more good things. But fame itself is very empty. It didn't mean much. Work was important to him.
Was Kermit Jim Henson?
No. No, Kermit was not Jim Henson. Kermit was a facet of Jim Henson, exaggerated, like the characters are facets of each of us. But Jim was an extremely complex person who was, on the other hand, quite simple. Kermit, in The Muppet Show, was kind of trying to keep this band of crazy people together, And Jim was trying to kind of keep these crazy people together in the Muppet and the Jim Henson productions.
Frank, how much do you miss Jim Henson?
I still can't believe he's gone.
Did you have a chance to say goodbye to him?
Afterwards, I did.
A great soul gone from us.
Yeah. Yeah, like John Stone said, the service must be this cosmic mistake. The finger pointed the wrong guy.
It's not that easy being green, having to spend the day the color of the leaves.
It was Kermit's song, and Jim Henson was the voice of Kermit. But at the request of Henson, his memorial service was not to mourn his death. Instead, it was called a celebration of Jim Henson's life, a life that created so much laughter. Henson wanted a service that could at least bring a smile. Children were at the service, many clutching the characters created by Henson.
Where is he?
Sesame Street waited a year after the death of the old storekeeper, Mr. Hooper, before attempting to explain his death.
Big Bird, when people die, they don't come back.
Ever?
No, never.
Why not?
Well, Big Bird, they're dead. They can't come back.
Another Sesame Street character was Ernie. Henson was his voice. And the Children's Television Workshop said Ernie will live on with someone else's voice. And the show said Kermit will also survive his creator, despite the difficulty in reproducing not only the voice, but the personality of the remarkable frog.
Now that I'm here, can you follow the focus here?
And if three whole people, why not four? And if four whole people, why not more?
Those questions about the future were put aside today to celebrate the life of Jim Henson and the joy that he brought to millions, children and adults. Stan Bernard, NBC News, New York.
Kermit the Frog. Hi, Kermit.
Hi, Jane.
With us this morning, you brought along Jim Henson, who was sort of what, your founding father?
Well, something like that. I've never really understood the relationship.
Yeah. And
but I don't have to.
You still sing Being Green much? Is it any easier? Does it get any easier?
I sing it at the drop of a hat.
Anybody got a hat?
A hat just dropped.
A hat just dropped. Sure. Can I sing it?
Please.
It's not that easy being green, having to spend each day the color of the leaves, when I think it could be nicer being red or yellow or gold or something much more colorful like that. It's not easy being green. It seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things, and people tend to pass you over because you're not standing out like flashy sparkles in the water or stars in the sky. But green's the color of spring, and green can be cool and friendly like, and green can be big like an ocean, or important like a mountain, or tall like a tree. When green is all there is to be, it could make you wonder why, but why wonder, I'm green, and it'll do fine, it's beautiful, and I think it's what I want to be.
Kermit and Jim Henson treating me to a song in 1982, and not just any song. That one was even covered by Frank Sinatra himself. Jim Henson's life ended too soon, but while he was here, he touched all kinds of people all over the world. Not just with his lovable Muppets, but with something in himself, his gentle humor, his creative spirit, his optimism. It's a good life, he said in a final letter to his children. Enjoy it. Jim Henson made it easier for everyone to do just that. That's Time and Again for now. Thanks for joining us. I'm Jane Pauley, and we're history. ¶¶